Today we are going to start with the examination and the diagnostic protocol in the fixed partial tension. Okay. So these are the contents of today's seminar. So we'll be starting with all the positive effect of the group loss, then the why you need a replacement of the group, indications and contraindications for the replacement of the group, then how the diagnosis is done, okay, by the patient's chief complaint, all the details of the patient, medical and dental history of the patient, and then the clinical examination, the radiographic examination, and the proper treatment planning. Okay. So these are the contents. So now coming to the introduction. So basically the definition is the determination of the nature of the disease. Okay. So basically we determine a disease process, how it is starting in the patient's mouth, and the whole process of the determination is done in the diagnosis. So basically, we have the fixed procedural test in which we replace the missing teeth with the artificial substitute. So basically we have three components or the parts of your fixed partial dentition, that is retainer, pontic, and the connector. Okay, so what are the effects of the tooth loss? So basically the first and the foremost effect is the drifting of the neighboring tooth. So basically we see the drifting of the neighboring tooth towards the mesial or the distal side or the space where the tooth is lost. So this is the age and periodontal related conditions can be seen in such tooth movements. So basically it depends on the position of the tooth in the arch. So we can see various, many of the time you can see the over eruption of the opposing tooth. You can see in this diagram, there is an eruption of the tooth of the maxillary arch and the mandibular molars. So there is a very common a scenario in the missing tooth. We have the eruption of the tooth in such a way that it goes down and touches the ridge of the patient. So we can see the adidas growth of the patient sometimes. There can be a traumatic occlusion also. And there are various reasoning for the treating the tooth. The first one and the foremost is the aesthetics. Aesthetics plays very important role, because if patient is having a missing or edentulous area in the front region or the anterior region, it is very difficult to have a patient having a social stigma is very common. So the functions, so basically when the patient is having missing edentulous areas in his mouth, it is very difficult to have the masticatory efficiency proper. So we have the pain during TM dysfunction also if the patient's posterior teeth are missing. There is difficulty in speech, obviously there will be a speech difficulty when the patient doesn't have any tooth present, and the maintenance of the dental health. So that's why we want a replacement of the missing tooth. The first and foremost aesthetic and the function. And then comes the speech and then definitive pain if it is present and the maintenance. So the next thing is the contraindication, where we should not indicate our fixed partial dentures. So when we have a large amount of bone loss in the traumatic cases, you can see in the first diagram there are trauma in the anterior region, maxillary arch and the mandibular arch. So the maxillary arch should be treated for the first for the bone augmentation procedure. Later on we can refer the removal prosthesis or any implant prosthesis if it is not indicated in such cases when the large amount of bone loss is present. So we have the young patients when there are the tooth having the pulpal chambers very, and patient with the long edentulous span. You can see in the second diagram, the patient's anterior teeth and the posterior molar is present. So there is a long edentulous space present in between the two teeth. So in such cases, we don't go for the fixed partial denture. This is because of the anterior long. The pericemental area of the missing or the edentulous area is more than the area of the teeth which are replacing the bridge. Okay. So next comes the bilateral edentulous arches, where the in Kennedy's class 1 situations we do not go for any fixed partial denture or the class 1 cases. So any distal extension case, and this is shown in the class diagram, that is the C diagram. You can see it on the right side, we don't have any tooth present posteriorly, so we cannot do the fixed partial denture such for such patients. So there are some contraindications also when we have the congenitally malformed tooth, which does not have the adequate tooth structure. For such cases, we do not go for the fixed partial denture. If we have the more amount of area of the tooth structure, then definitely we can go for the treatment of the same tooth. Prior, we go for an endodontic treatment of the same. So that if the patient is mentally challenged, in such patients, we don't go for the fixed partial dentures. Medically compromised patients, we avoid the medically compromised patient for the fixed partial dentures. If the patient is very old, in such patients, we don't go for the fixed partial dentures. Okay, we evaluate each and everything per the evaluation and the abutment selection is done. After that, if the abutments are solid, then we go for the fixed partial. Otherwise, we avoid the FPDs in such patients. So, before going for the examination and diagnosis procedure, we take a detailed case history of the patient, okay, which involves the chief complaint. Okay, while recording the chief complaint, we make sure that it is recorded in the patient's own word. Okay, so the patient's own word make a difference here. So we record it in the patient's own word. So we have the following categories in your chief complaint first. The first one is the comfort, or the pain intensity and the swelling of pain, the duration, the function, the social stigma related to that, the taste or the odor of the same thing, the appearance, if the patient's appearance is changed or if it is fractured, unattractive restoration or discoloration presents. So basically, we should have the chief complaint told that the ask by the patients in the same form. So now we have the personal details of the patient. We make sure that we take all the personal details of the patients, which include the name, address, phone number, sex, occupation, and the various financial status of the patient should be noted down. After that, we take the medical history of the patient. If the patient is having any medical history, the history of any systemic conditions, the condition which can affect your treatment plan can be taken into the consideration, or the possible risk which is having any changes in your treatment planning should be taken into consideration. Then comes the dental history. The dental history you should check thoroughly for the periodontal history. Then comes the restorative part of the restorative part also. The restoration should be taken into consideration. It is very important. It is for the longevity of the. So the next one is the endodontic history. If the patient is undergone any endodontic treatment prior to the prior in his last dental appointments, any orthodontic history is present, any presence of root resorption can be checked in the patient's mouth. Now we have the removal prosthetic history. We can also ask the patient about his previous dentures or the previous removal partial dentures. Can we ask any surgical extractions? Any post-traumatic history can be taken into the consideration. The radiographic history plays a very vital role in such cases. If the patient is having any dysfunction, history should be taken care of prior to your clinical examination. Okay, then comes the clinical examination. The first and foremost part is the head and neck examination. In that, we can check the profile of the patient properly. Profile of the patient is checked in the patient's mouth properly. The size, shape, and symmetry of the face is taken into consideration. The most important part is the cervical lymph nodes can be palpated. All the lymph nodes should be palpated properly. Okay. Then we check for the TMJ and the muscle of mastication properly. If there is any dysfunction, we should treat it first. So that is the evaluation of the TMJ. Okay. It is done in a various format. It can be started from the. So the you can see in this diagram we are doing the palpation of the TMJ joint. We can see the observations, the amount of mouth opening the patient is exhibiting. Okay, we can palpate all the muscle of mastications properly. Okay, after palpating muscle of mastication, we can go for the palpation of the lymph nodes also. While seeing the lips, we can make sure that the position of the lip, the aesthetics, the smile line should be taken into the consideration. Okay. Now we can go for the internal examination. We can check for the presence of any dental caries, recalcification, erosions, abrasions, attrusions, all the anabodies of the tooth which can be easily scrutinized. And we can check for the abutment evaluation. Okay. Now in the occlusal examination, we can check for the initial tooth contact, how the initially to contact in the maximum with the preferred position. The general alignment of the position can be properly seen. Okay. After that, we should check for the lateral and the protrusive contact. If there is any deflection, we should correct it before. We can check for the jaw manipulation for the proper movements of the jaw. The most important part is the periodontal examination. We should check for the gingiva or the periodontal properly. The first and foremost thing is the tooth mobility. Your tooth should be firm, it should not be mobile. If it is mobile, we can go for the periodontal surgery, where is periodontal scaling, polishing. Each and everything should be performed to counteract the tooth mobility. Then the position of the teeth should be evaluated properly. If there is any presence of open contact, or the contact areas are open, in such cases, make sure that we are correcting properly. The missing teeth, impacted teeth should be evaluated. If there is any gingival position, it should be taken into the consideration. For occasion, you know, if there, we don't do any fixed partial tension. We first go for a periodontal surgeries. Okay. The position of the frenum attachment should be taken into the consideration when we are replacing the anterior. So when we have the clinical attachment, CAL or the AL. So basically, it is very important. So basically, while it is taught me your periodontal lectures, basically. So the amount of periodontal destruction should be taken care of. For that, we should check for the clinical attachment level. It should be done with the help of Nevus probe. Okay. So all the things should be properly entered into your dental charting. So we can see here, the dental charting is done in the various format. The first one is occlusal, the lingual, the facial, then comes the lingual and the occlusal. Each and every tooth should be properly marked. You should have a radiograph of each and everything. You should have cast, the diagnostic cast of the same thing. The proper pre-operative photograph should be taken into the consideration before charting it. In the chart, we make sure that we are marking each and everything. If the caries is present on the molar, we mark this area. So we can treat this tooth first. If this tooth is missing, we mark it like missing. Okay. Each and everything is entered in your dental chart. So we can have the proper evaluation in a single page. So the edentulous areas can be classified into various categories. The first one, the classification for your ridge deformity was given by Siebert. It was told to you in the last class, Siebert's classification. Then we have the four classes. The first class is the normal, that is class N. Then comes the class 1, which is having the loss of facial lingual ridge only. The height is normal. We have the normal height of the ridge, but only the facial lingual ridge is lost. The width is lost, basically. In class 2, we have the normal width, but the loss of height is present. In the class 3, we have both width and height compromised. So what we do in the diagnostic class? Okay, we make a diagnostic class with the help of alginate and a tray, impression tray, which is a perforated impression tray for the alginate. We mix the alginate, we make the impression, and we get the diagnostic class. With the help of diagnostic, we can see the length of the crown, clinical length of the crown, how the morphology of the crown is built. The alignment of the tooth, the insertion, path of insertion can be evaluated. If you mount the cast with the proper bite, okay, we can evaluate the available pointing space. It is very important. It is very important to evaluate the spacing between the two natural teeth, the area. If it is evaluated properly, we can properly make sure that we can do the selection of the contact in a right way. So the next comes is the occlusion can be evaluated in the diagnostic cast. Soft tissue contours can be seen properly. Bony contours can be seen. If it is having any abnormality, it can be corrected in the earlier stages. Now comes the aesthetic factors. The aesthetic factors should be evaluated properly into the diagnostic cast. Next comes the radiographic examination. In radiographic examination, we have the the full series of intraoral IOPS. Okay. Then comes the panoramic film, that is your OPG. And the special radiographic techniques can be used to evaluate the TMJs, that is transcranial or the arthrography. A CT scanning sometimes it is done, MRI can be done. digital subtraction cryptography can be done, but these last four are avoided in the cases of when it is required in some special cases, otherwise it is not required. So we can see the panoramic films, that is OPG. In OPG, we can see each and every tooth with the proper bony and the others properly seen in a single film. Okay. Presence of an absence of the teeth can be evaluated by third molars or any impactions can be seen, or any infected tooth which is present, or any retained tooth which can be evaluated. In IOPS, we have the better details for the bone support and the quality of the trabecular pattern. You can see the trabecular pattern here, which can be properly seen. In OPGs, it is very difficult to say that the bone support and the quality of the bone cannot be seen that clearly. Okay, the root number can be properly evaluated in the IOPS. The morphology of the root can be nicely seen in the IOPS. The caries can properly evaluate. If it is present, it can be seen. The proximity of the root can be seen properly in your IOPS. Now, when we go for the radiographic interpretation, we should check. The first thing we should check for the periodontal ligament space, the width of the periodontal ligament space should be evaluated. If there is any trauma from the upper genitus, always violated. The areas for the bone loss, vertical and horizontal, can be seen. If there is any furcation, it can be evaluated in this region. The axial inclination of the teeth can be checked for the parallelism of your abutment. If these are parallel, you can go for the preparation of the tooth. Pulpal morphology and the previous treatment should be properly evaluated. You can see here there is a endodontic treatment done prior, which is having a post here, so it can be evaluated in the radiographic examination. The presence of apical diseases, if any apical diseases are present or any root resorption is present in the patient's tooth, it can be seen clearly in the IOPS. It should be evaluated properly if there is any root fracture also. So we can see the retained root pieces, and it should be checked beforehand. There should be any calcification can be checked. If there is presence of any infected root, it should be checked properly. So basically, there are presence of various caries lesions can be seen, and it should be completed before your fixed partial denture, before starting of your fixed partial denture. Then we come for the biodegradable testing. So we should make sure that the patient's tooth is vital before preparing it. If it is not vital, we can go for the we can go for the root canal treatment. So basically, the first and foremost thing we can check is the percussion. We percuss the tooth vertically and laterally for vitality, but it is not the exact or the ideal method for the percussion of the vitality testing. The thermal or the electric stimulation is the one of the best method to go for a vitality testing. There are various vitality testing kits are available in the market. So the next one is the preparation of the test cavity without any local anesthesia. It is detrimental to the patients. We avoid this. The best method is the second method, that is the thermal and the electric stimulation. Okay. Next comes the treatment planning. This is the last part of your presentation. So basically, what are the objectives of the treatment planning? So basically, the objective is the correction of the existing disease. If the patient is having any existing disease, it should be corrected in such a way that it does not look like any procedure is being carried out in the patient's mouth. So we make sure that it should be corrected in such a way it should mimic the patient's previous natural tooth. The prevention of the future disease, if it is, can be corrected beforehand, should be prevented. Restoration of the function. We basically try to restore all the functions which will help you for the mastication of the patients and the appearance of the patient. So these are the basic objectives of the treatment plan. So we go for the replacement of the missing teeth. The first and foremost thing in the replacement of the missing teeth is the span. Now we consider the removal partial denture on one side and the fixed partial denture on the other side. So basically, wherever there is a span length, the large span areas are always replaced with the removal partial denture. when we have the more amount of edentulous area, the removable partial denture is the choice of treatment. When we have the more amount of edentulous area present, which include the larger area. When we have the smaller areas where only one or two teeth are missing, in such cases we can go for the conventional tooth supported fixed partial denture. Now, this configuration of the spine, if there is no distal abutment or the distal extension cases, should be always done with the help of removable partial denture. We avoid the avoid the distal extension cases for with the help of fixed partial denture. Okay. There should be a distal abutment present for the fixed partial denture. If it is not present, we refer for the removable partial denture. Okay, we avoid the cantilever pontic in various situations. Okay, if the cantilever areas are present, we go for the removable partial denture always. The abutment alignment. If the inclination of the abutment is more than 25 degrees, we prefer the removable partial denture. If it is less than 25 degrees, we prefer the FPDs. Okay, we can accommodate in the preparation if it is less than 25. Okay, now condition of the abutment is vital role. If we have the small, short clinical crown or insufficient abutments, in such cases, we prefer the removable fixed partial denture. When we have the abutment condition good on 120, which is having the proper clinical crown height and the width, in such cases we go for the fixed partial denture. The occlusion, it is seen, it is more acceptable for the irregularities in the occlusion with the help of the RPDs. For your FPDs, we should have a proper favorable loading areas with the having which are having the normal magnitude, direction and the frequency. Or the duration of the forces should be properly evaluated. After that, only we can go for a current condition. Whether the condition is good or bad, we can always go for a removable partial denture. But in the weakened abutment, we always prefer the fixed partial, removable partial denture. FPDs are prepared, preferred in the when the patient having the good bone support, the crown root ratio is adequate. At least 1:1 is ratio is there. Okay, there is no mobility present. It is having a favorable root morphology and the rigid stabilization. With each and everything is normal, we prefer FPD. Otherwise, we prefer the RPDs. Okay. Next comes the ridge form. So basically, the ridge form is the if the residual ridge is proper, ideal. In such cases, we go for the fixed partial. If there is no bone loss, the soft tissue is defect. In such cases, in cases of class 1 and class 2, we prefer fixed partial dentures with small modifications. If it is in class 3, C-Birch class 3, we always go for the removable partial denture. Now coming to the general features which are evaluated in the patient's mouth. If the patient is having the dry mouth, we don't go for the RPDs basically. When the patient's financial condition is very critical, in such cases we prefer RPDs only. Oral hygiene is acceptable, RPDs. These are the various lists you can go for the fixed partial denture. Same thing is done for your resin bonded bridges and the implant retained bridges. Okay. So there are types of bridges. So this is the fixed face bridge in which we have the distal and the mesial abutment. With the help of that, we can replace the missing teeth. So we have the fixed removable bridges. Okay. These are not done anyways. So basically we have the fixed movable bridges which are having the male and female component in the abutment. Okay. We have the cantilever bridge. Okay. This is the tooth and this is the replaced tooth. Okay. We prepare only single tooth. With the help of this tooth we are replacing the adjacent tooth. This tooth. Okay. So this is cantilever. The spring cantilever. Okay, we are replacing a lateral incisor with the help of a molar. We prepare the molar and a spring cantilever bridges to replace the anterior. We have the various adhesive bridges. Okay, there will be Maryland bridge, Virginia bridge. There are various types of bridges can be adhere or bonded to the tooth for the functions. So we now coming to the retainers. So there are various types of retainers, which is divided into extracoronal and intracoronal. We are starting with the intracoronal first. So the first intracoronal retainer is the complete hiatus, which we prefer in the normal. So the complete linear crown is always preferred. Then comes the partial linear crowns, three-quarter crowns, reverse three-quarter crowns, 7/8, 1/2, and the rigid contributors. So these all are the extracoronal retainers, okay, which can be given over your coronal structure. Okay, now comes the intracoronal retainers. Intracoronal retainers can be inlays, onlays, pinlays, restorations, or the radicular retainers. So now coming to the pontic design, we have discussed in the last class about the various types of pontic, the indications and the contraindications of pontic. So again, we are just skipping these areas. You can have the various designs depending upon the reach condition. You can choose it. It can be used differently. So we have the non-mucosal contact, that is sanitary pontic, which is around having a gap of 3 to 4 millimeters from your reach to the pontic. So same thing, it is a modified sanitary reverse baby, reverse fish baby pontic. So now coming to the biomechanical consideration in your treatment planning. Okay. In your treatment planning, basically, while making sure that biomechanical consideration should be taken into the consideration, long span bridges always go for a removal bachelor tension. So because there are so many bending and the deflecting forces are acting on the bridge, so it will tend to dislodge your fixed partial denture in such a way that it will come out into the patient's bone. So dislodging forces will be more and the bending and the deflecting forces are more in the long span edentulous areas. And we have the double abutments. Double abutments are preferred. You can see in this diagram, we prefer the double abutments when we have the unfavorable crown root ratio. Okay. If you want to increase the perisemental area, you can go for a added number of your abutment tooth. When we have the arch curvature plays vital role. It affects the pontic area. It will act as a lever arm, and it will have the torsional movements in the patient's mouth. It will tend to deflect your bridge or the single tooth crown. So basically, okay, now the consideration in the treatment planning. So basically, what we consider during your treatment plan, the first and foremost thing is the patient's considerations. So basically, we should make sure that the patient is, we are fulfilling all the patient's desires. It is the very important part. All the patient's expectations should be taken into the consideration and the needs. Okay, patient should not have the unrealistic expectations. All the realistic expectations of the patient should be taken into the care. We should make sure that all the systemic and the emotional health factors should be evaluated earlier So when the patient is having any systemic or emotional diseases, in such cases we try to cover the diseases prior. After that we go for the partial danger. When the patient requires any antibiotic prophylactic treatment, it should be provided. If the patient is having any bruxism present, we treat it first and then go for the actual treatment. Now when we go for any infectious diseases, it is very stressful. Basically when the patient is having a hepatitis B and AIDS, proper care should be taken for treating such patients. When the patient is having any environmental factors, inflammation, percussion, or any percussion involvement, in such cases we don't go directly for the treatment, preparation of the drug. We make sure that we are correcting all the underlying pathologies of the patient and start with the preparation later. So when the margin placement is taken into consideration, we should make sure that the gingiva is the healthiest at that area. So if we make sure that if it is not healthy, we always prefer to go for the subgingival preparation. Okay. Supragingival preparation. If the patient is wants highly aesthetic, if the patient is demanding aesthetics, in such cases we prefer for the subgingival margins. The first and the foremost requirement for the recommendation for your subgingival margin is the aesthetics. Then comes the retention. When the clinical crown height is very less, in such cases we go for the subgingival margin to increase the crown height. When the there is a presence of caries which are present in the persisting restoration of the subgingival caries at present, when the patient is having root sensitivity, in such cases we go for the subgingival margin placement. If the patient is having cervical erosion or the root fracture, in such cases we try to go for the subgingival restoration. So last time we also discussed about the biologic fit. So the biology bit should be maintained in such a way that we do not encroach the biologic bit. Okay. It should be prepared in such a way that we are not going beyond this area. You can see this sulcus. There is a bone present here. The connective tissue present here. So basically, it is done in such a way that we are not going beyond the sulcus. Occlusion of the patient should be evaluated, all the forces should be evaluated properly. The aesthetic factors should be taken into the consideration. The space, basically the pontic space plays a vital role here. When the patient's pontic space is narrow due to the drifting, basically it happens because of laser and distal drifting of the abutment present. So in such cases we have very limited limited areas for replacement of the tube. It is very difficult to correct it aesthetically. For that, we have to go for the orthodontic treatment first, then we can go for the fixed person. So next comes the width of the pontic space. When there is a more amount of width of the pontic space, in such cases, we can plan out for the different types of pontic or the connectors that can be a loop connector can be used if there is a way to more amount of space present in between the anterior teeth, or the orthodontic correction can be done in such cases. Now coming to the endodontic consideration. After the endodontic treatment, basically we have the loss of remaining natural tooth. So basically there will be more amount of area is lost. There is insufficient remaining tooth structure present because of the caries which was earlierly present. We remove the caries, we replace it with the help of. So basically in such cases, we can go for the post-synco, then fabricate a crown over it. When we have the insufficient amount of tooth structure present, we can go for elective endodontic treatment for abutment selection. It is already discussed. We should have at least 2:3 ratio for your crown and tooth. At least 2, optimal 2:3, and minimal 1:1 should be there, crown root ratio. Now come to the root proximity, the path of insertion, it is already discussed. When we have a tilted path of insertion, we can go for the various types of connective. Okay. Connective design. This is the key and KV type of repeater. which is given in this case to correct the path of insertion. Okay, if it is very difficult to correct it with the help of preparation, then we go for the orthodontic treatment. Okay, we do the drifting of the tooth in such a way that we get the proper amount of filling which is required. So we can select abutment for the cantilever also. For such cases, we should have the primary abutment properly having a proper crown root ratio, ideally, which can replace a lateral incisor with the help of the canine or the posterior tooth, taking into the entice block consideration. Now we can go for the pyre abutment. Pyre abutment is which? So this is the tooth. You can see this. Okay. This is the abutment which is having edentulous areas, mesially and distal tooth. So basically, it can be restored with the help of non-rigid connector. Always. Okay. Otherwise, we will have the unfavorable leverage forces or the unsettling forces on acting on this bridge. That's why we don't use a complete bridge here. We have the fixed movable type of bridge in this condition. We can splint the tooth when the patient's long-term service is considered. Splinting is very essential. When you are in a doubt, there is definitely you should go for a splinting. The combination of the fixed and the removable partial denture is a very nice idea for the replacing previous tooth. It also preserves the bony conditions of the patient. The tooth will also function properly. There will be proper appropriate reception from the mouth. Okay, we need a comprehensive treatment planning and prognosis should be evaluated properly. So these are the factors should be taken into the consideration when we are considering for the treatment and the diagnosis. So these are the references you can go for it. Okay, the first one is the Rosenstiel, which is very nice book. You can go always refer that in the sharing. Okay. So these are the books can be preferred for your referencing of the same. So this completes our today's topic. We'll be continuing with the different types of retainer in the next class. After that, all the preparation for this, all the ways of preparing your complete crown removal, partial removal crowns, all the things will be discussed in the next class.